give him the glory. Great things he have done. Praise the Lord. Somebody told me K-I-S-S. Everybody in the military know what that means. Keep it short. Simple, keep it simple, sweet. On to you. I got the message. I'm not going to say you see it. Look at it and say, oh my God. But that's all right. We're going to be short anyway. But we're going to do it. But the Lord says do. Praise the Lord. We sue our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to make the news and the contentious. All our trustees, trustees, crew, and all our trustees, and all our officers, we thank God for everybody that came to get this going. Thank you for coming. We just thank the Lord for everybody. All right, we're going to move right into our sermon, and we're going to let you go as soon as possible.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. So don't try to arrest me, please. All right. Amen. All right. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Was reading your hearing earlier. We read verses 1 through 10. I want to look today at two verses. Verses 9 and verses 10. Paul the Apostle wrote to the church at Corinth. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. But when I'm weak, then am I made strong. I want to talk today briefly on the subject, God's grace is sufficient. Amen. Say, tell a neighbor, neighbor.
Neighbor.
God's grace.
God's grace
is sufficient.
Is sufficient.
Now tell somebody in case they don't believe it. Tell them,
God's grace
is sufficient. Now take those hands and put them together. Warm up a little bit.
Yeah.
All right. God's grace is sufficient. In our society today, mankind as a whole is searching for answers to a diverse multiplicity of problems. Crime plagues our neighborhoods. Chaos is becoming the normality. What used to be sacred has become holy. Rights of sinful, promiscuous individuals have all but superseded the rights of godly-minded, spirit-led, law-abiding citizens. Secular media and communicative mediums have called Judeo-Christian values obsolete and unmeaningful for today's generation. Christians trying to live a purposeful, useful, and meaning life in the realm of the spirit are literally being bombarded with the plagues of a morally corrupt world system.
Right.
We all are suffering as a result of the ills that exist all around us.
Mm-hmm.
There is, if you would, a disease called AIDS, which has catapulted to a level where it has touched almost everybody in one way or another.
Mm-hmm.
It has had an effect either on somebody in our family or someone else we know in our communities. Murder has spread its ravenous paws into our communities, especially those of the African-American persuasion.
Yes.
Going to the grocery store for a loaf of bread in the daytime, not even considering nighttime travel, has become a virtual adventure through a web of fear. We are faced with decisions which can and sometimes will alter the course of our future. I know I'm talking a little philosophical, but just stay with me today. Seems like we can't see our way through this maze of confusion, but when we stop and think about it, God's grace is sufficient for me. When we give some serious thought to the matter, that we are going to realize that the grace of God paints a very different picture on the canvas of life. Why do I say that? Because the world seems to be out of control. But God's grace steps in to carry us through a mean and cruel time like today. Understand today, church, that God's grace is unmerited. That there's nothing we can do, Mr. Woods, to earn it. His grace, if you would, breathes upon us every day of our lives. It was grace that woke us up early this morning. I don't believe you know that, but that's what happened. It was grace that woke us up early this morning. It was God's grace that has brought us thus far.
Amen.
The grace of God is grace that shows love, favor, and compassion towards, listen to me, all mankind. Even those who do wrong do not understand that God's grace gives them another chance. Yes. To be able to get right with the master of the universe.
Yeah.
It's only God's grace that will let people kill one another and still be able to have a chance to get right with God when they've done their dirty deeds.
Yeah.
It's by God's grace that when we do what we ought not to do, He gives us one more chance to try to get it right and to do what is right. The Bible says that your Father which is in heaven, maketh His Son to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. God's grace also extended to the Apostle Paul, who considered himself to be the chief sinner among men. The same Apostle Paul who received letters from the Jewish high priest to persecute Christians in Damascus. We find here in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, and verse 9, the Apostle Paul receiving an answer to a previously prayed petition to his Almighty God. You see, Paul has sought God's face concerning a painful physical ailment. The Bible says that he had a thorn in his side. And I don't know how that must have felt. That must have been not some kind of painful to have a thorn in your side where you had to call on God and ask Him to remove it. So it couldn't have been something that small because you could have just pulled it right out. And y'all with me today? You could have just pulled it right out and that'd been the end of the story. But it must have been something that was mighty, mighty powerful. That he couldn't take it out on his own. That he had to call God and ask God for rescue from the problem. The Bible does not tell us exactly what the thorn was. But some scholars have suggested in the light of Galatians 4:13-15 that he may have suffered from some type of eye affliction. Or that he might have been a sufferer of migraine headaches. But the thing is that irregardless of what the thorny ailment was that it existed and that it troubled Paul in mind, in body, and in spirit. The Bible says that this thorn was a messenger of Satan used to buffet Paul lest he should be exalted above measure. The thorn got so bad that Paul had to pray 3 separate times to try and get some kind of relief. You know, you know how that when you touch a rose bush, it has stickers pointing outward. That sticker goes through your finger. And it will cause pain, discomfort, and it oftentimes will cause your finger to start bleeding. But you don't call on God and say, God, remove this pain of the thorn of the rose bush. Because that pain is only a minor pain. And it's a pain that can go away after a while. But the thorn that was in Paul's side was a thorn he couldn't get rid of. And it was a thorn that Satan used to buffet him or to beat him down with this ailment, whatever it was. You see, physical thorns hurt and cause discomfort. And we all from time to time have thorns in our flesh. We sometimes have physical thorns like Paul had, but oftentimes we have spiritual thorns that cause great pain to us in our spirit man and to others who are around us. We have weaknesses and shortcomings which act as thorns to someone else. We have thorns of gossip. Love the gossip. Run our mouths on the cell phone and on the telephone. Talking a lot of junk. About what we don't know what we're talking about. At the time, we're talking about it and it don't even make no sense. But we just talking because it make us feel good. Here to be the one that said, I got to tell you, child. I got the story. You like the man used to be on the TV coming to the barber shop. I got it. I got it. And I got this. Report. Y'all remember that's my mama. Y'all not like he just came out the sky. You know that show. He said, I got it. He was a mailman.
Yeah.
But he wasn't delivering mail, he was delivering gossip. Because he could tell you everything. And he was watching everything. Some of us gossip and ridicule each other. We love to be able to tell the unstole story on somebody else.
Yeah.
But they don't want nobody to tell the story on us.
That's right.
Am I right about it?
That's right.
We think we perfect.
That's right.
Don't do no wrong. So anybody got nothing on me. Let me tell you, baby, just like you watching them. Somebody watching you. I'm saying, I got a feeling. Somebody watching me. You wouldn't talk about God either. Somebody watching me. Yes, sir. We just like the tabloid newspapers. Filled with truths, half-truths, and even sometimes just full-blown lies. Some of us have thorns of indifference because we have apathy towards any and everything. We seem to be unconcerned about anybody but ourselves. We do not care what anyone else thinks or even how they feel. Because if it's not our program, we don't want no part of it. Some of us have stumbling block thorns in our side. These kind of thorns can cause a person to put stumbling blocks in other people's way. So they may trip and fall by the wayside. And we can sit there and laugh and talk about how bad they are and how good we are. But understand, if you dig a ditch for your brother, dig one for yourself too. Because you're going to fall in right along with it. Am I right about it? Some of us have thorns of confusion and argumentation in our side that make us just love to keep confusion and arguments going daily. Anybody listen, I want to argue. Anybody hear me, I want to fight you. Don't even know what you're fighting about half the time. Like, what are we fighting about anyway? You want to kiss and make up. All these problems and bad spiritual attitudes are thorns in the side of a Christian who's running or proclaiming, if you were to be running, the race towards the mark of perfection in Christ Jesus. We need to be like Paul the Apostle and pray earnestly to have these type of thorns removed from our side. The Apostle Paul had a physical ailment, but it's not the physical ones that hurt the worst, but it's the spiritual ones which sometimes hurt us and do the most damage to us and all those around us. The spiritual thorn is what Satan uses most effectively to cause us to want to give up. Throw in the towel. And say, Lord, I'm done. I'm not going back out there again. Too cold in that tent. Not doing it no more. Not putting on no coat, no jumpsuit, going out sitting in that tent again. But look at here. That God will bless you somewhere along the way. When you look around and something happened you didn't expect, and God said, here's your blessing. Because he said, be thou faithful unto death, and you shall receive a crown of righteousness. Am I right about it? Am I right about it? Yeah. Satan will sometimes make us sound just like Popeye, a cartoon character. Warrior used to tell Pluto in anger, that's all I can stand, and I can stand no more. You remember that cartoon? Yeah, you do. You were watching it the other day. There's a war going on. There's a war in the spiritual realm. Because the Apostle Paul says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of the world, against spiritual wickedness and happiness. That's why the Bible tells us to put on the whole armor of God, that you might be able to withstand the fiery darts of the devil. The villain, the one called Satan, alias Lucifer, who seeks to kill, steal, and destroy. But God's grace is what will hold us in the battle. When the devil thinks he got us, they cold today. I got to put on blankets and they wondering what I'm doing here. Why am I coming to church? But God's grace said, just hang in there, baby, just a little while longer.
That's right.
I will bless you for your faith forever. God never misses anything.
Right.
He sees where you're at right now.
Right.
And he understands what you're going through.
Yes.
But he says, that's all right.
That's all right.
You can start in a tent, but end up on the side over there in a brand new building. Church is through. Just hang in there long enough. And I heard one fella tell me, I'm getting old now. I don't know if I'm going to make it. But I told a young man that you can't leave here until your work is done. Can I get a witness?
Yeah.
I don't care how old and how much pain you in. God said you're going to do what I got for you to do.
And
then when your work is done, I'll tell you, well done. You faithful servant.
Yeah.
Yes. I got to understand that all this stuff that's going on right now is just a rehearsal.
Yes, it is.
Somebody say, we're just rehearsing.
Yes.
So when we get to heaven, we're going to really say, just boom, my LP, I don't know up there. I want to be in her choir.
Right.
Don't put me in that choir.
That's
I want to put me in her choir.
Right.
I can really sing.
Yeah.
She's going to play.
Yeah.
See, her fingers fall off.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. God's grace.
Right.
It's efficient.
Yes, it is.
In hard times, God works the best.
Yes.
Shines his life of relief from heaven on us.
Uh-huh.
God. I used to have mama sing a song.
Mm-hmm.
God. Specialize. In things grow. She used to say,
grow.
Yeah. Impossible. He would do. No other power.
Uh-huh.
She just stop right there and say, Holy Ghost power. And you.
Go ahead.
I was actually singing that moment. She used to sing when I was a boy.
That's right.
She got two kids to sing there. Right.
Right.
She
was
singing a song. God. Yes, she did. Specializing.
Yes, she did.
God specializes in things men call impossible.
Yes, yes,
he will do what no other power can do.
That's right.
Stop right there.
Yes.
There's some things that even the devil cannot do.
That's right.
Because he had some power.
That's right.
But God's got all
power.
Can I get a witness? God got all. I want you to understand that. You don't remember nothing else today. Remember, God has all power. And so thusly, I can understand. That his grace
is
sufficient for me.
Yes.
His strength is made perfect in weakness.
Jesus
was on this earth around 2,000 years ago.
Mm.
He was truly God and truly man.
Yeah.
The God man.
Yes.
God incarnate. Walking in the flesh.
Yes.
One day he got weak as he pondered the cross. And his cruel ramifications. As he thought about the cruel death he was about to suffer, Jesus looked at the ramifications of the problems. His mind started wandering back to the agreement that was made with God the Father up in heaven.
All right.
Jesus let his flesh suffer that the will of God may be fulfilled.
Yes.
For Jesus came to die even though he was sinless. Yeah. He came that all sinners might have life and have it more abundantly.
Yeah.
He came that we might be redeemed by the spilling of his blood on Calvary's cross.
Right.
You see, for what the shedding of blood, there is no remission for sin.
Yes.
Your blood could not do it.
Amen.
My blood could not do it.
Uh-huh.
But only the blood of the perfect Paschal Lamb was able to make a propitiation for our sins.
Yes.
The sins of this world was imputed upon our generation in the Garden of Eden.
Yes.
But they had to be removed.
Uh-huh.
And all sin had to be blotted out.
Yes.
That's why Jesus came.
That's right.
He came that grace of God might be revealed through him.
Mm-hmm.
For God so loved the world
that
he gave his only begotten Son.
Yes.
That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And I'm glad to know today that
everlasting life
is free.
Free.
You see, if I had to pay for it, I'd be lost and spiritually bankrupt.
Yes.
I'd be broker than I am right now.
Go ahead.
I'd be in worse condition than you could ever realize.
Uh-huh.
But he came.
Yes.
Jesus came.
Yes.
That love might abound.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And I'm so glad to know that God's grace is sufficient.
That's right.
It was sufficient for Paul.
Uh-huh.
God's grace was sufficient for Abraham.
Uh-huh.
It was sufficient for my mama and sufficient for my grandma and my granddad.
Yeah.
God's grace is sufficient for you.
Amen.
God's grace is sufficient for me.
Uh-huh.
God's grace is sufficient for the whole world.
Yeah.
His grace will pick you up
when
men have knocked you down. Can I say it again? God's grace will lift you up when men have knocked you down. Because there's some men that like to knock you down a lot. Because they're down, they want you to be down with them.
Yeah.
I say, I'm not going to sit down there.
Yeah.
Because of God's grace, I'm going to get up and take my place.
Yeah.
Be the Lord. Because God's grace is sufficient for me.
Yeah,
his grace woke me up early.
Yeah.
Early this morning.
Yeah.
done now. Started you on your way. Somebody said this song that God's grace is amazing. Amazing grace. Sweet the sound. Save the wretch like me.
Strong.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Power of God.
Yes, Lord.
Resting on me.
Resting
on me. So there's no time that God turns his back on us.
No.
Because his grace stays down there in the dirt right along with you.
Yes, sir.
Yes, get it together.
That's right.
Let's come back.
That's right.
Just as I am. Walk down the aisle.
Yes, Lord.
Take the preacher's hand.
Yes.
Say, I'm back.
Back.
Do God's work. He never turned his back on you.
No, he doesn't.
I don't care what you've done.
That's right.
He won't turn his back on you.
That's right.
Because he's God.
Yes, he is.
And his grace.
Yes,
he is. Sufficient. Let us stay.
Yes,
it is sufficient.
Yes.
For me.
Yes.
Doors of the church are open.
Thank you, God.
Everybody
thank you. Want
today, who is not a member, want to come. You can join the letter.
Thank you, Lord.
Came from baptism.
Thank you, Lord.
It's an experience.
Thank you.
Whatever way.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
God's grace is standing right now.
Thank you, Lord.
To receive
you. Thank you, Lord.
And maybe you've been in church all your life. You never got saved. You've been in church all your life. You never really turned your life to God.
Thank you, Lord.
You come pray. We're praying to you right now.
All day.
Yes.